In March of 1978, Larry spotted an ad for a talent contest sponsored by Harp Lager and CBS Records.
We didn't really think that we had a hope in hell of winning this talent competition. I think there was a £500 cash prize and a guaranteed record deal. So we entered this competition and we in fact won it, which was amazing.
You two went home exhilarated. They decided they needed a manager. Paul McGuinness worked in the Irish film business and was interested in getting into music. On May 25th, 1978, he saw U2 perform. He was impressed. Paul agreed to manage the band.
One of the first things Paul McGuinness did for us as a manager was get us served alcohol. That was when, okay, he's going to come in handy.
There's a place I go that takes me far away. And there's a late, late show where I can grow. Sometimes a hero takes me. Sometimes I can't let go. Hello, hello. Stories for boys. Stories for boys.
In late 1978, a personal tragedy shook U2. Larry's mother, Maureen, was killed in a car accident and Larry was heartbroken. He tried to withdraw from his friends and from U2, but Bono wouldn't let him.
He came around to my house and just said, look, I understand what's going on because it happened to me, and maybe I can help you. And that was, you know, and he basically forced me to be in the band. When I say that, I mean he wouldn't let me go. And during the early years being on the road, I mean, I was 18 and 19 and I was scared, you know. I really was scared. I you know, knew nothing about what I was entering. I had no idea. And he, I don't think he did either, but he was just a lot more streetwise than I was. And at times it just got really hard and he was always there, he was always around. I was just, we wouldn't even have to say anything, just I knew that he knew. He knew what was going on and he understood what was going on. And, you know, it's been a long relationship and it's based on very deep things. And Bono's probably the only person in the world who could really hurt me. And I would be able to stand back and go, it's fine, it's okay, I could deal with it.
Not long after Larry's mother died, some of U2's friends persuaded them to come to a meeting of a charismatic Christian group called Shalom. They sang gospel songs, prayed together, and discussed the Bible. Larry, Bono, and Edge began to attend the meetings regularly. Adam wasn't interested.
We were just really curious. It's the big question, you know? And it still is. And the stuff that I picked up in that intense period of time, I'm still living on.
At the start of 1980, U2 ended an Irish tour at the National Stadium in Dublin. 2,000 people showed up. It was the largest crowd they had ever played to, and they delivered a riveting performance. The show climaxed with more than 30 people dancing on the stage. A talent scout named Bill Stewart offered the group a deal with Island Records on the spot. U2 went into the studio to record their first album with producer Steve Lillywhite. Boy captured a freshness and optimism that had been lacking in rock for years.
I was on the outside when you say you stay and you let me in. I was looking at myself, I was blind, I could not see you.
I think the reason why we probably didn't emulate or simulate is we couldn't play other people's material when we started, so we had to develop our own. And it was because we started, I think, writing early. We started working on our own compositions early. Is the reason for, I think, what I believe is an original sound.
Boy was released in October to very positive reviews. On December 6, 1980, the band made their American debut at the Ritz in New York City and won over the jaded Manhattan crowd. U2 started getting played on college radio. Eager to confront the American market head-on, U2 played ballrooms, colleges, and small clubs across the U.S. Watching the landscape of America go by the bus window, Bono scribbled lyrics for new songs. The life of a rock and roll band on tour was full of temptations. Bono, Larry, and Edge struggled to reconcile their Christian beliefs with their chosen profession.
It was certainly incongruous, you know, to see a rock and roll band down the back of their tour bus, you know, with their heads in the back of the Bible, you know.
It was causing a rift between the three believers and Adam, who was trying to have the time of his life. He was a 21-year-old in a rock band on tour in America. It was all he ever wanted. He intended to live it up. Manager Paul McGinnis sided with Adam. He wasn't against their Christian beliefs, he just didn't share them. And he saw that it was causing a problem within the band.
What we went through in the early 80s was a kind of baptism of fire. We went down to the water and we just almost drowned in it, you know, our heads were under the water there.
Their born-again friends were telling them that they needed to quit the band in order to live a Christian life. Paul McGinnis and Adam Clayton were horrified that Bono, Edge, and Larry were seriously thinking of breaking up the group as a sacrifice to God. It looked like U2 was going to put out the fire just as it was getting started.